My name is Jeremy Rifkin from the United States of America.
Professor Rifkin, thank you very much for being here today with us in Aprendemos Juntos. It's such an honor to have you here. As a start, I would love to give the audience some context. So with the data we're managing right now, what does the future look like?
It looks dangerous and hopeful. Let me start off and with this, a little bit of a context here. We're facing an unparalleled moment in human history. And I think I better start off by telling all my friends that the viruses are going to continue. We're going to have more pandemics. That's very clear. And I want to explain why this is happening. It has everything to do with the changing climate on this planet. You know, when my dad was born, 1908, 85% of this entire earth was wild, all wilderness. There was no human development. Today, it's shriveled to 24% of the world being wild. And here we have 8 billion human beings huddled in these major urban metropolises. And what's happening is this, the viruses are now climate migrants. They're migrating as the wilderness depletes faster and closer to our urbanized civilization. And this is a real problem. It's compounded by an equal problem, climate change. And of course, they're both completely related, the two of them. And that is, we are in real-time climate change. This is no longer a theory. When I first began working on these issues in the 1970s, it was still speculative, all right? No longer. What we're beginning to see is a dramatic transformation in the way this planet is evolving. We were not designed for this new world. And that's the issue at stake. Let me explain what climate change is all about. Once it's explained, I think everyone that's listening to me today will have a clear picture of what we need to do. There are four major spheres on this earth that animate all of life. The hydrosphere, the waters, and that's the most important. We're the watery planet. 70% of this planet is water, and all life is animated by the hydrosphere. Then there's the lithosphere, that's the soil, the plants, the animals, the trees. And then there's the atmosphere, the oxygen, and then the biosphere, which encompasses these spheres. But the hydrosphere is the mover of everything on this earth. Here's the issue. 200 years ago, we dug up the burial ground of a previous period of history, the Carboniferous era, and we exhumed the dead bodies of plant and animal life from that era. They had morphed into coal, oil, and natural gas. And we took those dead bodies, coal, oil, and natural gas, and we created an entire civilization based on this stored energy, all right? So now what's happened with the industrial age is we've spewed so much of these global warming gases into the atmosphere, CO2, methane, and nitrous oxide, that they're blocking the sun's heat from getting back off the earth. So what we're seeing here in real time is a planet that is actually changing fundamentally because of climate change. For every 1 degree Celsius, this is what I want everyone to hear. For every 1 degree Celsius that the temperature goes up on this earth, the atmosphere is sucking up 7% more precipitation from the ground because the heat on the ground is creating more evaporation quicker into the clouds. More concentrated precipitation in the clouds, more wild, extreme, exponential water events. I'll give you an example. These atmospheric rivers we're hearing about now, these massive atmospheric rivers in the winter, 15 feet of snow in Southern California for months this winter. That's unheard of. There is no snow there usually. And then flooding for months after that. In the spring, all over the world, we're getting spring floods, ecosystems destroyed, agricultural crops can't go in, people losing their lives. Then in the summer, we're getting the droughts, the heat waves, and the firestorms destroying our ecosystems. Then in the fall, we're getting the hurricanes and typhoons. That's all about the hydrosphere. We had the hubris to think over the last 6,000 years, since the beginning of hydraulic civilization, that we could actually sequester the entire hydrosphere, the waters of this earth, control it with the dams and the rivers and the reservoirs for the exclusive use of one species. Now the hydrosphere is rewilding with global climate change. And our scientists are telling us, I want every young Gen Z and millennial to hear this, but especially the parents and grandparents as well. We are now in the sixth extinction of life on this planet. It doesn't even make the headlines. This is the most important moment and the most important story since we've been here. And remember, we're the youngest species. We're the babies. Homo sapiens have been here about 200, 250,000 years. Our scientists are telling us that we are likely to see 50% or more of our keystone species extinct in the lifetime of today's babies. We'll never see them again. We'll never hear them again. They had been here for millions and millions of years. The last extinction event was 65 million years ago. So we have to understand that for every 1 degree Celsius that temperature goes up, we're going to see more and more of these events. The question is, how do we address this? It's interesting to see the response of the young people, the Gen Z and millennials. So this Friday for Future demonstrations, young people took off their school classrooms on Friday afternoons. They walked onto the streets, millions of them, over and over again, 141 countries, and called for a climate emergency, right? Mm-hmm. And what's interesting about these protests, I didn't really catch on to it until I was in Milan and I met with several of these young protesters, and it dawned on me. We've had protests all through history. Human beings love to protest. I mean, we protest all sorts of, you know, things that need to be addressed. This was different. This is the first time an entire generation, millennials and Gen Zs, have come out on the streets and they see themselves as a species. They are actually identifying themselves as an endangered species. And they're seeing their fellow creatures as part of their evolutionary family. This is extraordinary. All the other divisions are still there. You know, our national loyalties, our religious ties, our family ties, our tribal ties, but they've gone one step beyond and said, beyond all this, we're a species. This gives me some hope. The second thing that gives me some hope before we get into the details on this, it gives me a little bit of hope, is that we have thought for a long time that we could dominate this planet. You know, our Western history goes all the way back to the book of Genesis. It's our first pseudo-historical record, if you will. So if you go back and recall, as every young student does, we have Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. The Lord says, don't eat that apple from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. I'm going to expel you from the garden. They couldn't help themselves. They ate the apple. He expelled them from the garden. But the Lord said to Adam, I'm going to give you something because you have to now live by your toil. There's no paradise for you anymore. I'm going to allow you and all your heirs to be dominion over all the species that live on earth. You shall have dominion over everything on this planet. The Eastern religions were quite different. They saw human beings as harmonizing with nature and part of nature. That mandate has stayed with us for thousands of years, all the way through the hydraulic civilization, the industrial age, and then to the crisis we're having now. And that is that we have taken ourselves and our fellow creatures to the end of the line with the idea of dominion. Now, I think we're beginning to realize, and this is a big change in consciousness, like the Gen Z seeing themselves as a species. We're beginning to realize this planet is much bigger and more powerful than ever we thought, when we thought we could have dominion. And our species is much smaller and less consequential and not needed on this planet. These are two great changes in consciousness that actually are a good story, because they tell us that the playbook we've been living on is no longer workable. It isn't just about changing a few things. In our conversation today, we're not going to just talk about changing a few things. What's led us to the crisis is not just fossil fuels blocking the sun's heat from getting off the earth. It's the way we've conceived of governance, how we organize our economic life, our relationship to nature, our approach to science, how we educate our children, even our notions of selfhood, these basic categories that we've used, all based on dominating this planet, have taken us to an extinction. The problem, we're using these same set of assumptions to try to get a cure to the crisis that started the crisis. I don't care if it's the World Bank, the UN, the OECD, the IMF. We need a new playbook. In the Age of Resilience, I attempted over those 9 years to take a look at what a new playbook would look like, not in theory, but in practice. because what I cataloged and chronicled in the book is all of the work that we've done and others have done in Europe and China and America and other parts of the world to say there is a new way to understand our misgivings and to forge a new future.
You say in your book, In the Age of Resilience, that what put us here is our culture of efficiency, right? And you talk about resilience and biophilia, and I would love you to explain what is the role of resilience for this new future, and what does biophilia mean?
All right, those are big topics. let me go back and provide a frame of reference for efficiency. The interesting thing about our species is that we are the only species that creates elaborate infrastructures to bring large numbers of people together as a social organism to maintain life, all right? Let me share an anecdote. Back around the year, I think it was 2001, Romano Prodi came to the U.S. Embassy here in Washington. He was president of the European Commission, twice the prime minister of Italy. He sat me down, and I knew I was in trouble. He held my hand for 1 hour, okay, wouldn't let go. He said, look, you spent a lot of time in the U.S., 25, 30 years. They're not moving. Come to Europe for the next 25 years. We're going to address climate change. We're going to create a new playbook. We're going to address this issue. We're going to change the world. I took him on it, up on it, got a lot of frequent flyer miles over the years. But what's interesting about it is when we sat down in the EU, we asked a question that no one had asked. We said, from an anthropological point of view, what are the great changes in economic history? How do they occur? If we know how they occur, maybe we'll get a roadmap and a compass here in the EU and the rest of the world for a new journey. And when we look back at history, we found something that's not in the textbooks. I had written about it here and there.
Yeah.
And that is that all the great economic paradigm shifts, there have been 7 or 8 major ones, they all share the same common denominator. That at a moment of time over a civilization, 4 defining technologies come together. It's usually serendipitous. New communication technologies, new sources of energy, new modes of mobility and logistics, and new ways to organize water. When those 4 technology changes come together, they fundamentally change every aspect of our life. They change our temporal spatial orientation. They change the notions of governance, our ways of organizing economy, our social life. Et cetera. And this is something that's important for folks to hear, because they think infrastructure is just, isn't that just like the roads we go on and the bridges? No. Governments don't create infrastructures. These infrastructures that serendipitously come together with new technology breakthroughs, they determine the kinds of governments that could operate within those infrastructures. Mm-hmm. All right? There's variation, but you can't go outside. Same with the temporal spatial orientation and the way we organize economic life, et cetera. So, for example, every organism has to operate the same way. If you take a look at every cell in every organism, they have to have a means to communicate, a source of energy to stay alive, some motility or mobility to maneuver, and water. So this isn't rocket science. Our social organisms are infrastructures that allow us to come together in much more complex ways. So you asked about the temporal spatial orientation. Let's take a look at that concept, efficiency. I started writing about that about 40 years ago. I don't think many people paid much attention to it back then because we thought efficiency is just the way of nature. Doesn't every species try to be more efficient? No, this is a completely new concept. Through all of our history, we've been here. Hominids developed about 800,000 years ago. Neanderthals about 300,000 years ago. Our species, Homo sapien, 250,000 years ago. We have a lot of Neanderthal blood in us. If you take your DNA test, there's quite a bit of DNA. But what's interesting, throughout our history, we did what every other species did. We adapted temporally to the rhythms of nature. Every organism has myriad biological clocks. Right now in my cell, there's biological clocks in my tissue, in my organs. And they are moment to moment temporally adapting to the hourly changes in metabolism, mm-hmm. the rotation of the earth every 24 hours, that's circadian rhythms, the seasonal rhythms as we move across the planet, mm-hmm. moves across the sun. That's how every species adapts. It's adaptivity, not efficiency. What's interesting is that in the modern age, we began to have a love affair with efficiency. It was emerging all the way with the hydraulic civilization, but it really came to bear, and I'm not going to go into a long song and dance about it, in the modern age. And here's what efficiency is. It's divorced from nature. It's based on the mechanical operations of an industrial system, all right? When we set up time zones, for example, around the world, is to actually make the planet adjust to us rather than adjust to the planet. Efficiency is extracting greater volumes of the planet. That means extracting greater volumes of the hydrosphere, the water, extracting greater volumes of the lithosphere, the land, the plants, the animals, and the atmosphere, the oxygen, and the biosphere, extracting those volumes at greater speeds and shorter time intervals to increase the opulence of one species among millions, ours. Then we wonder why we are only less than 0.5% of the biomass of the Earth, and our little teeny species is now using 24% of all the net primary production on the Earth, and 44% of that net primary production in 20 years ago, and then we can't understand why there's an extinction event. So, efficiency is a strange value. There's no such thing as efficiency in nature. It doesn't exist. It's adaptivity based on our biological clocks. And the twin of efficiency is productivity. There's no such thing as productivity in nature. It's regenerativity in nature. In nature, there's no such thing as growth. It's flourishing in nature, all right? And efficiency, I work with the business community. My background's business in economics. In business, we say efficiency means eliminate all the friction. We don't want any friction. We don't have too much inventory. Lean production so that we can send some of the revenue back to investors. Lean logistics. We don't want to have too much redundant logistics. Send some revenue back to the investors. Not too much bigger workforce. Too redundant. But in nature, favors redundancy. Redundancy. Instead of spare, you have to have a lot of redundancy. You have to have a lot of diversity. All right. So if you take a look at everything that in the natural world, which we're a part, and then you look at the way we've organized our temporal value, doesn't fit. Let me also talk about our spatial orientation. For most of the time we've been on the planet, like our fellow creatures, space was the animated existence in which we lived and had to flourish. The hydrosphere, the lithosphere, the atmosphere, the biosphere. It was a commons. That didn't mean that people didn't try to take over other people's land sometimes, but we saw the waters and the land as a commons. That began to change a long, long time ago with hydraulic civilizations. But in the pre-industrial age, our John Locke, who you read in school, he changed the equation. They were already getting ready. He said, look, nature's waste. That was his exact words. John Locke, the great political philosopher, nature is waste. It is passive. It's not doing anything until we add human labor to it. And when we add human labor to it, we make something out of it, of value, and then it's capital. Totally got it wrong. The physiocrats, the early economists out of France, they got it right, but the Brits took over, and the Scottish economists. The French said, look, it's photosynthesis is the wealth of the planet. It's called net primary production. They were washed out as we moved from an agricultural industrial age to an industrial age. So again, we have to reset ourselves, and we have to move from efficiency to adaptivity. And we have to begin to understand that the planet has its own animation. This planet's totally animated temporally. It's not passive. The hydrosphere is shifting every moment. The mountains are degrading every moment. The lithosphere and the soil is changing every moment. It's all in flux. It's a self-evolving, very complicated, and very exciting adventure in the universe that's going on here. We don't have a clue.
You were basically explaining that at some point we got disconnected from nature, right?
Yeah.
And I ask you about this biophilia term that I would love you to explain. What is, because you were talking before about these new movements that are kind of reconnecting with the nature, right? That say, hey, we're a species as well.
I had written about empathy in many books over the years. And then I took about 9 or 10 years to write a book called The Empathic Civilization. And my wife said, are you out of your mind? No one's going to read 650 pages. I wrote it for myself, basically, all right? What I found is something interesting. I was wrestling with a quotation by the great philosopher George Friedrich Hegel. And he said something to me in writing about 40, 50 years ago, and I kept with me. He said, happiness are the blank pages of history, because those are the periods of harmony. What the hell was he talking about? I kept thinking about him, thinking about it over the years. It turns out, which is interesting, if you read historians, if you like to read history, historians always register all the huge traumatic events that affect us because they imprint an indelible imprint on us, all right? We remember them. The Portuguese earthquake, for example, or terrible events that happen when entropy sets in a civilization. These terrible historical events. When you read history, you get a pretty bad picture of the world. It's a Hobbesian world when you read history, but those are not what happens day to day. And that is day to day, we are biologically configured to be empathic. It's actually in our neurocircuitry. Our scientists finally discovered mirror neurons about 25 years ago. It's in our neurocircuitry. We're not sure. We think elephants have it, and maybe dolphins and whales who started on land and then went back to the water. What it is this. It's in our neural circuitry, it allows us to be able to experience the other as if we're actually experiencing ourselves. It's not up here. All of what comes up here comes from down here in our empathic neural circuitry. Now, we're born with that. For example, when babies are born and they're all put in a nursery and one baby cries, all the other babies cry. They just don't know why they're crying. By around 2 or 3, young toddlers start to understand that they're an individual. And when about 7 or 8, they understand about people dying. That's when they really become aware that life is precious, that we're here for a moment, that we're on a sojourn with our fellow humans and hopefully our fellow creatures. And when I empathize with another, I'm actually experiencing either their dread, their despair, or even their joy, and I feel it in my body. Not as if it's mine, but it feels like it's mine. This is an extraordinary value, but it can be inflated or it can collapse, depending on your culture, depending on parenting, depending on the society one lives in. So empathy is actually our strong suit. It allows us to cooperate. There are moments when empathy expands. For example, forager hunter societies, they had empathy, but only for blood ties and family relations. If you were another tribe in the next valley, maybe a demon, all right? When we went to the great hydraulic civilizations, the big dams and the dikes and thousands of people in urban situations, that's the same time that all the great religions formed. It's not a coincidence. All the great axial religions formed when the great hydraulic civilizations came in Mesopotamia, the Indus Valley of India, the Yellow River, Yangtze in China, Mesoamerica. And because when you brought large numbers of people together who were not blood related, how do you get them to empathize? The great religions, you became the parent figure. So if you were, for example, a Christian in first generation Rome, and you came in from all across the empire, and you were all alone, no more blood ties, no more local goddesses, Jesus became the father figure, the greatest empathic figure in history. And so when Christians would meet each other with their robes on in the Roman streets, they would kiss each other on each cheek, which Europeans still do, hello, brother, hello, sister. And they would die for each other. When you get to the modern age, nation states, the new father and mother figure were your nation states. They were a fiction. You know, when they created Italy, premier of Piedmont said, now that we've created Italy, how do we create Italians? Because they were all different ethnic groups. In France and all these countries, these were fictional realities. But eventually, public schools, common celebrations, common calendars, and eventually the French all see themselves as a fictional family and they'll all die and live for each other and give their lives for each other. There have been moments of empathy expanding and then completely being destroyed. Now these young people, they are into a new stage of empathic consciousness. It's quite extraordinary. They see themselves as a species. They see their fellow creatures as part of their family. And they are extending empathy to what we call biophilia consciousness. E.O. Wilson, the great biologist at Harvard, before he passed away, wrote a little book on biophilia. He wasn't the first to introduce it, but he made the point that there are two things that we know are in the neural circuitry of human beings. One is parenting, the parental regard. All of our ancestors had that, and empathy in the neural circuitry. He just didn't develop it. So these young people now are beginning to sense an empathic engagement, not only to each other, but their fellow creatures. When that polar bear mother with the little polar bear cub on that ice sheet in the Arctic, you saw that advertisement over the years, and they couldn't get off the ice sheet, it was melting, everyone cried. When that little koala was taken out of that tree burning with their paws in Australia 2 years ago, everybody cried. We understand this. What we have to realize is that Thomas Hobbes and those guys got it wrong. We're not this terrible creature that's always looking out for our own interests. No, that can happen. It depends on one society. But in our neurocircuitry says that's not our basic instinct. That's a secondary instinct. So I think the young people are beginning to create biophilia consciousness. The problem is all those other forms of consciousness that are no longer on the ascendance, they're still here. They'll battle because they want to hold on to their sense of what a community is. So right now, as I speak to you today, there are still ideological wars going on right now. There are religious wars going on right now this morning all over the world. There are tribal wars going on right now all over the world where these old forms of consciousness are threatened. And now the young people are saying we are a species. That is both a hopeful sign and it's a threat. So there's no guarantee here. It depends on whether we are at a moment in history where we're ready as a species to come together. And the possibility is there. The question is, will we be up for it, or will we not be able to be tested and be able to take the challenge?
As you know, this is an educational program, and with empathy and compassion as key elements for the future, and with education following this efficiency model right now, how do you think education can foster empathy and compassion in young people?
Let's start with the basics, our biology. There's I think of all the sections in the age of resilience, the section that resonates with me the most is rethinking what a human being is as a creature. And that gets to the basis of re-educating ourselves. In the Western tradition, as I mentioned just for a moment, we've always thought of ourselves as independent of nature, the masters of nature. God gave us nature as our kingdom to control. The Eastern religions were better, Taoism and Hinduism and Buddhism, the philosophy of Confucianism. They at least understood that human beings are part of nature. We harmonize with nature. Have they strayed from that? Yes, but at least it's still in their cultural DNA. But in the Western tradition, we thought we could dominate nature. Now, something has happened that's so extraordinary. And what I'm about to say is going to give hope to every young person and every grandparent that wants their grandchildren to make it, and every parent. The National Institutes of Health, the most august scientific institution in the world, and in Washington, D.C., four blocks from my office window in Bethesda, Maryland. They have inaugurated a new project which most people don't know. It's going to change everything. It's called the Human Microbiome Project. This project re-educates the human race. And what they've discovered in the Human Microbiome Project is this. We are an ecosystem. I want everyone to hear what I said. I'm not talking about a metaphor. All the great scientists in America in this project are saying, guess what? Every human being is an ecosystem, literally, not a metaphor. So, and our ecosystem is changing moment to moment like the rest of the ecosystems. For example, our body is changing every moment. We think of our mature skeleton. Everyone has a mature skeleton and that you have that for your lifetime. The human skeleton is totally replaced every 10 years. You have a completely new skeleton every 10 years, a completely new liver every 365 days. Stomach cells are replaced every month. There are a few cells that stay in our body for a lifetime since birth, some of the lens in the eyes, some of the cells in the brain, the phosphorus for our teeth, et cetera, but they then go somewhere else. So every moment, the water from the hydrosphere comes into our body in the form of molecules. That's 60% of the body, all right? And then that water is maintaining the metabolism in every cell. Then those molecules go somewhere else. They don't disappear. All the water on this planet was here from the beginning of time and to the end. It doesn't disappear from the planet. But also the elements from the lithosphere are coming into us at every moment. The phosphorus in my teeth, they came from the mountains. The mountains were degraded by the waters. The waters degrade the mountain into the sediment. And then all the little elements like phosphorus and all the other elements in the sediment and the soil are taken up by the plants and the animals. Then they come into my teeth. Then the phosphorus goes somewhere else. It doesn't disappear. So our bodies are moving as a semi-permeable membrane every single moment. That's an extraordinary. Then it gets even more interesting. The National Institutes of Health are telling us we're not alone in our body, folks. There are millions of creatures in our body that we're just beginning to analyze in science. There are the proteas and the archaea and the fungi and the bacteria and the viruses, millions of them in this ecosystem. And you know what? Human beings, we're only 44% of all the cells in our body. The other 56% of all the cells in our body belong to these other creatures. And we think our genes are important. We only have 20,000 human genes in this body. There are millions of other genes that don't belong to us. This is an amazing adventure. We're realizing each of us is unique, but we are at every moment a medium in which the hydrosphere, the lithosphere, the atmosphere, and the biosphere is coming into us in the form of atoms and molecules and organs and tissues. Then they're going somewhere else, maybe another human, another animal, maybe into the soil. This is an amazing experiment in the universe. This is so hopeful, younger generation. We don't have to be afraid of nature because we are it. We don't have to hide away in a virtual world of the metaverse and scared to go outside. You know, the 90% of the day in America, people are indoors. It's true in most industrial countries. And 7 hours a day around most of the world, we're on a screen. And now we're given the metaverse. Now, I have no problem with the digital world, as you know. The third industrial revolution infrastructure is all digital. But when we began to hide away and be frightened, and of course the planet is evolving in very extreme ways, we will be lost. We have to embrace the planet again. We have to learn to adapt to the planet again. The problem we faced is that for 95% of our history, we adapted to nature like every other creature. 10,000 years ago, the last ice age receded, nice climate came on. Oh boy, nice weather, very predictable. And so we settled down. No more nomadic life. We became agriculturalists, pastoralists, hydraulic civilization, all the way to the Industrial Revolution, the Age of Progress, extinction. All right? We have to have a reset. And this is the biggest reset in history. We have to now, instead of adapting nature to us, which took us to this point, we have to now adapt ourselves to nature. Understanding the National Institute of Health program, so it's not a big job. We are nature. We are an ecosystem. And instead of trying to manipulate the rest of the planet for our own opulence, let's use our physiology to be able to, in a more sophisticated way, learn how to live on the earth. We're not going to be forager hunters in the old way. We're too sophisticated. We have to change, however, our approach to science. Our approach to science is so sophomoric. It sometimes gives me a smile, and sometimes I just say, my God, what did we do here? Remember Francis Bacon from high school, founder of modern science. He said, man was not made for nature. Nature was made for man, end of quote. And he said, we'll take this common little heart of the earth and we'll shake her to her foundations. That's the founder of modern science. And the idea of modern science was, we detach ourselves from nature and we become objective observers. And using induction and deduction, we force nature's secrets out so that we can then commodify them, propertize them, extract them, and use them and consume them. All of modern science is based on objective, deductive, and inductive science. Throw it away. it's taken us to an extinction event. The good thing here is there is a whole new approach to science emerging within the scientific community, in the academic community, and this is a real, real step forward. It's called complex adaptive social ecological systems modeling. It's a mouthful. I call it CASES, C-A-S-E-S. And what we're learning is that our academic disciplines are too siloed. If you're a chemist, you only know about chemistry. If you're a physicist, you only know about physics. If you're an economist, you only know about economics. They don't talk to each other. But the planet is very complex. The planet is not dead, passive matter to be extracted. The planet is moving at every moment. Let me back up for a moment. We tend to think of space as structures, objects, and forms that are passive, all right, and atemporal, and can be extracted, propertized, commodified. But the point is there's a completely different approach to nature to understand that its patterns and its processes, and it's not objects and structures. Everything's moving at every moment. There is no such thing as an object at a moment. Alfred North Whitehead, a great philosopher of the 20th century, got it. But two guys that are more recent, Norbert Wiener, who created cybernetics, and Bertil Lamphy, general theory, systems theory, they both said, hell, everything's a process and a pattern that's moving, evolving, and changing moment to moment in a planet that's completely alive and animated. Our forager hunter societies, way back when, they understood there was an animated Earth. They were animists. We need to be animists in a new way to understand a sophisticated way. So the academic disciplines are starting to cross the borders. The physicists are working with the anthropologists, are working with the ecologists, are working with the literature people. And we're beginning to understand this complex world requires a systemic approach across disciplines. We need to understand that the planet is alive, its patterns, its processes, its flows. And to adapt to us, our disciplines have to be able to work together to anticipate and respond to nature, which is part of us, rather than to preempt and take and dominate. That's the reset. We have to go back and understand nature in a more sophisticated way. That's a new approach to science, a new approach to academic life that will serve us well. And this is, I started working with an old friend, Rusty Roy, passed away years ago, one of the great scientists in the country. We started working on this in the 1970s, and he created science, technology, society curriculum, the first interdisciplinary curriculum. But now, the younger generation of academics break open the walls. And that approach to academia needs to be clinical. You cannot just learn in a room. We have to learn out in the natural world. We have to have clinical teaching, service learning. So young people from grade school on don't see ecology as a course. It's an ecological framework for all the other courses. All right? And therefore, beginning in first grade, we do this. Germany, very interesting. They have forest schools, thousands of forest schools. We've got several hundred in the U.S. So during the COVID pandemic, these forest schools took off because parents were going nuts, the kids were going nuts. And so forest schools, they take 4 and 5 year old kids, even 3, 4 or 5 year olds, and they have an ecology guide. 365 days a year, they take them out into nature. Rain, shine, snow, doesn't make any difference. There's no shelters, no nothing. And they let the kids explore life. And it's so exciting. The young people love it. They remember it the rest of their life because it's they see freedom as inclusivity. Our generations have always seen freedom as exclusivity, the right to be autonomous, not beholden to others, in charge of her own destiny, as long as we don't hurt someone else's chances. For a younger generation, freedom is exclusivity is death because they're all connected in networks, right? They're all connected in networks. The little kids are learning about networks. And so all of a sudden they're out there in nature and they see a whole swarm of bees come and they spend 30 minutes on it, thinking about it, it's so exciting. And they are creating biophilia consciousness. When they do studies of what little toddlers dream about when they're 4, 5, and 6 years old, you know what they dream about? Over 60% of their dreams are about animals, little animals. They identify with them. They identify them. So we've got to get our young people out. And these forest schools are very exciting. This is the future. And it has to go from forest schools to grade school, to high school, to university, to graduate schools, to the business community.
And I want to know your opinion on what the role of education is to build this, to design this new future?
Well, I'm in some conversations now with universities that are interdisciplinary around the world, and we're looking to put together, there's quite a bit of conversation in the last 2 years, we're looking to put together a global consortium, beginning with the universities, but also with the high schools. We've done it in some regions. Our global team, as I said, we were principal advisors who established the Third Industrial Revolution for the EU, China, and some of the plan that went into the US plan. But we spent a lot of time in regions. And I'll give you one example. We spent 10 years in Hauts-de-France. That's the industrial region of France, 10% of the population. The president of the region came and he said, will you do a plan for a third industrial revolution transformation for the region? And I said, won't do it. He said, what do you mean you won't do it? I said, it's a waste of your time and a waste of my plan, because we'll do a plan. It'll sit on some shelf. You'll have a press relief and some minister will announce a pilot project. We're too late for that. But I said, if you want to go back to the entire region and get every mayor, every chamber of commerce, every university, every high school, everyone together, so they do the plan and we'll work with them, come back. And they usually don't come back, by the way, so I'm usually off the hook. This guy was extremely on it. He came back months later and said, well, everybody's lined up. So I said, well, then the plan's going to be your plan. We will help you with all of the regions we've worked with over the years with our industries, but we will work with your experts because you know who you're all about as a region, all right? And we will work with you. And over 10 years, we did. And they created thousands of projects, thousands of people involved, thousands of people involved. They took all the chambers of commerce through the Third Industrial Revolution plan. But then they hit the universities and high schools. The Catholic University of Lille got together the 26 other universities. They began to move their entire facilities into zero emission. They introduced interdisciplinary studies. Then they brought the 230 high schools in. The Catholic University of Lille has clinical learning. So all of the students have to learn in teams, and each team, members of the team have to teach each other. The professor is still the guide, but they have to be able to help each other because learning is not something I own, it's something I share. So the idea that knowledge is power, Francis Bacon, bye-bye. Knowledge is the ability to have experiences of our sociability in the world. So team learning, they haven't eliminated grades, but you pass and fail with your team. And then they now have clinical learning. In America, we call it service learning. Starting, they have to go out in the community and work with the knowledge in the community and work with the ecosystems they're in. If this can be done there, this region, and all of everything else, they've created tech parks, new jobs, businesses. We didn't do it. We work with them, they did it. And what I'm saying to everybody listening to me, every region in the world can do this tomorrow morning.
You often talk about on how digitalization and artificial intelligence are transforming the job market. And now I wanna know, how can we prepare the young generation for this new job market? What kind of competencies and skills do we have to?
We have to go back to what I said earlier, and that is to know how the great economic paradigm shifts occur, because those paradigm shifts create the new opportunities, the new business models, the new employment models, the new way we organize our economic life together. So as I mentioned, when you look at the great economic paradigm shifts, they all share four common denominators: new sources, new ways of communicating, new technologies to produce energy, new sources of mobility and logistics, and new approaches to water. So they are what every organism needs. And that is a way to communicate, a source of energy to stay alive, some kind of mobility and motility, and they have to have water and a habitat. So our what we call a social organism are the infrastructures of society, right? And they create all the new opportunities. If we take a look at the first industrial revolution in the 19th century, British Isles. Mm-hmm. So the communication revolution was steam power printing, all right? No more manual printing, too slow, those old German print presses. Steam power printing mean you could have something new, cheap books for public school textbooks for something called school public education. Otherwise, we wouldn't have had the money. And then they created newspapers and journals so we could communicate. Then the Brits put a telegraph system across the British Isles in the last half of that century. That communication revolution combined with a new source of energy. They went from denuding the forest for energy. There were no more trees. They went to coal underground for their energy. And then they created the steam engine, and they put the steam engine on rails for railroads. Railroads allowed us to have urban development. And then when you put them all together, communication, energy, mobility, the railroads, then they put in the first sewer systems and water piping into homes and factories. That took us to national markets because we brought everyone together as a social organism. It took us to nation-state governance. It took us to shareholding companies, stockholders. No monarchy could afford all this. Second Industrial Revolution, the U.S. were the opportunities. The communication revolution, Alexander Graham Bell, the telephone, I mean, the whole continent, boom, instant communication at the speed of light. In fact, at first, people didn't believe it was real. Do you know the word phony in English? The word phony?
Not really.
It means you're not real. That they used to, when people talk to each other on the phone, they call you a phony, not real, because they didn't believe it, that it was really happening. So communication revolution, the telephone, and then radio and TV. The energy revolution, cheap Texas oil. We didn't need coal anymore. The mobility revolution, Henry Ford put those automobiles out, internal combustion engine, road, then rail, ocean, inland traffic, air. The habitat revolution, our semi-permeable membrane, our skin. We went from urban to suburban habitats all over the world, all right? We went from national markets to globalization and global mediating institutions like the World Bank, the OECD, the UN, et cetera. That second industrial revolution, by the way, peaked. We know when it peaked, July 2008. We actually know the month. That was the month that Brent crude oil hit $147 a barrel on world markets. That was a record. The whole economy shut down that month. We saw it coming. Why the earthquake? Everything depended on oil and does and fossil fuels. It's not just powering our cars or heating our homes. It's our pharmaceutical products and our cosmetics and our synthetic clothes and construction materials. So when oil goes over 80 a barrel, everything else goes up. And inflation goes up and we're in trouble. So where are we now? Second Industrial Revolution is sunsetting. It's on a deathbed. There's no one in the business community or government that I work with that thinks that we are still in the sunrise of the fossil fuel-based industrial civilization. It's all stranded assets, right? So I'll share an anecdote. When Angela Merkel became Chancellor of Germany, she asked me to come to Berlin in the first couple of weeks to help her address the question, how do we grow the German economy on her watch? When I got to Berlin, the first question I asked the chancellor, I said, Madam Chancellor, how do you grow the German economy when your businesses are plugged into a second industrial revolution infrastructure, centralized telecommunication, fossil fuel nuclear power, internal combustion, road, rail, water, and air transport, and the traditional infrastructure and buildings that go with it? And we know that infrastructure peaked in its aggregate efficiency, the ratio of useful to potential work, in the last 20 years in every industrial country. Every infrastructure has a birth, a life, and a death. This is in the deathbed. So I said to the chancellor, you can have market reform and labor reform and fiscal reform. You can incentivize all sorts of startup companies, AI experiments, robotics. Won't make a damn bit of difference if they're plugged into that infrastructure to communicate power and move life. So on that day, we discussed a third industrial revolution. It had already been really evolving quickly in the European Union. And here's what it is. The communication revolution is the internet. It's already very mature. We have 4.5 billion people connected. And in the palm of their hand, a tiny little smartphone with more computing power than sent our astronauts to the moon. 4.5 billion people. Now that communication revolution is converging with an energy regime. We now have millions and millions of people producing their own solar and wind. When I wrote the book Entropy in 1980, and it was the first book after the National Academy of Sciences warned of climate change, and I said we got to move to solar, and a few of us were doing it. Well, in that time, a fixed watt of solar was $70. You know what it is today? 33 cents. Solar and wind are now the cheapest energies in the world. So what's happened is, with this third industrial revolution infrastructure, is that the communication revolution, the net internet's in, and now there's an energy internet. We have millions of people that are generating their own solar and wind in their homes, their offices, their neighborhoods, their farms. And within 20 years, hundreds and hundreds of millions. We're putting solar and paint and glass everywhere. The sun and the wind shine is everywhere. Fossil fuels are only a few places, and uranium. And within 25 or 30 years, we will be sharing solar and wind on a global energy internet. It's already starting, using big data analytics and algorithms to share solar and wind across oceans, an underground, under ocean, a cable, already starting, across the planet in time zones. So when it's sunny in one time zone, take up the sun, store it, send it to another time zone where there's wind on that part of the world at night. They do it and they share it up. Solar and wind force sharing, because no global company can share, can control every landscape or any country. There is absolutely no way for any country or company to actually capture the sun and the wind everywhere in the world. So we're moving, if you will, to an energy internet. That means it'll be totally distributed infrastructure. You will have some utility scale infrastructure in the farms, but everyone's gonna have solar and wind, but it forces sharing. And it brings the world together in a different way. Then those two internets are converging with a third internet, mobility and logistics internet, electric and fuel cell vehicles, powered by solar and wind from the energy internet. Then they become increasingly autonomous, and they're managed by the same big data analytics and algorithms that we are now using to manage energy around the world and manage communication. They all three come together. It's a single internet. They converge with a final internet that's just starting, the water internet. The problem is not water. People have a hard time with this. They say, gee, there's floods. And then months later, there are droughts. They don't put them together. We are not running out of water. I want everyone to hear this. The water that's been on this planet has been here from the beginning. It will be here to the end. The question is not water. It's now when the water comes, where and how much. For 10,000 years, we had a pretty predictable climate. We knew all of when the water would come, when would the snow melt, it would be appropriate time for having the fields with water so you could put the crops in. Then in the summer, there'd be less water. And then by the fall, there wouldn't be any water, but the crops were in and everything else. Well, now the hydrosphere is changing its mind. So we're developing a water internet where we're beginning to harvest the water when it comes in your home, on your roof, in your community, in what we call sponge cities. And then you have underground cisterns, and it's happening now, starting to scale. Mm-hmm. So you keep the water where it is, and then you can move it with the electricity internet and the water pipes when you need it, for human consumption, for industrial use, and even hopefully for irrigation. And then we're mixing that with desalinization of the oceans. 340 million people now rely on all their water from desalination. So there are all of these promises, things together that take us into this new world. And that's where the jobs are and the businesses and the new opportunities. So when parents say to me, or grandparents, can we do this? Our global team that did the plans for with Europe and China and the U.S., our U.S. plan, and this is based on industries, not academic theory. This is what we know the market can do, what the technology can do, what the financing is that is available, what the returns on investment. It's all open source. Anybody can look at our website and see the 500-page plan. Much of it that went into the Schumer plan. We think this can be done in 20 years in terms of the market and technology. What's missing is political will. We need a new generation in political will. We need the millennials and Gen Zs, because the older generation, and I'm not blaming them, when the young people come to them and say, we have an emergency, it's a climate emergency, an extinction event, and the local regional government will say to them, you know, we agree with you. This is a really serious problem, and it's one of the most serious problems that we're dealing with. The moment the kids hear it's one of the most serious problems, how can anything be more serious than the extinction of life on Earth? We need a new generation of young men and women going into political office, because the old codes, the old regulations, the old standards, the old interest in the fossil fuel industry, it's time for a new generation of political leaders. And then we can move this thing forward. The opportunities are enormous. Remember I said crisis creates opportunities. So when we talk about the new jobs and businesses, I'll leave you with one more. All the real estate in the world has to be completely changed. The existing real estate has to be retrofitted. It has to be redesigned. It has to be resilient to earthquakes and to climate disasters. That's got to be done right now. Think of the jobs in construction and building materials and real estate. It's enormous. Robots and AI do not do any of this. It's ridiculous. I mean, I'm all in favor of developing whatever we can in digital technology for the third industrial revolution infrastructure. But robots and AI do not put solar panels on roofs, and they do not steward water ecosystems. It's too complicated, all right? It takes too much dexterity. So there's a room for the metaverse, but it's childish. It's naive to think that we're somehow going to create a second world and be able to completely distance ourselves from the planet we live in. It's almost humorous if it weren't so sad. Wake up, grow up. That's what I would say within the halls of government. Let's get the young people in there. We've got a lot of young men, especially young women, going into government now at high levels. They're the future, the Gen Zs, the millennials.
And regarding AI, there are a lot of challenges, but there are also a lot of opportunities regarding AI, right? I don't know if you can give us some example of AI used ethically and in a way that we can use it to get to this new society.
Let me start with how we can use big data, all right? Because as you know, the third industrial revolution infrastructure that we've evolved over the last, since 1995, it's all digitized, all right? Communication internet, energy net, mobility, logistics internet. Let me give you an example. There's a system called GRACE, G-R-A-C-E. It's just a bunch of satellites, not even expensive. It's incredible. What GRACE does, those satellites, they monitor every square foot of the planet every moment in terms of change in gravity. And by understanding the change in gravity, they can use that with the data to determine exactly what's happening. Is the soil depleting? Is there water that they're losing the water in the hydrosphere? They can take a look at everything going on in climate change at every moment. It's extraordinary. And then that data can be used. So you create a new calendar. Instead of just knowing what's the weather for the next 7 days, you can know in every place on the earth what is actually going on with the hydrosphere and the lithosphere and the atmosphere and the biosphere. Moment to moment, it's almost free. It's very inexpensive. That's the use of data that really makes sense in a world where we have to steward the planet. One of the problems with over-relying on data, and as you know, there's a big section of the book on that, is that big data is all based on something that's already happened. So it doesn't tell you about what's about to happen. It's so ridiculous to think. It's so naive. Sometimes I don't know whether to smile or to frown when I think about what goes on in Palo Alto and all these folks in the high-tech labs. It tells you what has happened. But the problem is, and the opportunity is, this planet is evolving in ways we've never seen in 65 million years, and it's all in one century. And we think past data somehow is going to tell us how to deal with a planet that's completely animated, always has been. It's in movement at every moment, the hydrosphere, the lithosphere, the biosphere, the atmosphere. It's transforming itself in ways that are beyond anything we've ever experienced. The past data doesn't tell us much, all right? What we need to do is move to pragmatic science. Now, the pragmatist scientists in the early 20th century, like Dewey and Mead and these guys, they did understand that instead of trying to take nature and preempt it in order to control it, we need a science that's based on anticipating nature and adapting to what it tells us to do, because we are nature. Since we are an ecosystem, I would say, our responsibility, our biological clocks try to adapt. Mentally, we have to be able to use complex thinking and systems thinking to anticipate what's happening, and then when it does happen, respond, anticipate, respond. Do not preempt and control. That's taken us to extinction. So there's a role for big data. Well, they forget one important thing, that the most important part of our neural circuitry is our empathic impulse in our neural circuitry. That allows us to be able to understand what life is all about and be able to flourish, all right? Big data cannot be empathic. Empathic requires mortality. It requires a life and a death. When people are empathic, it's a realization that if I feel somebody else's suffering, their grievance, and I can experience it as my own in my neural circuitry, I know it's not me, but I can experience it that way, or their joy, what I realize is that we are kindred spirits at one moment in time. We're sitting here on this planet, and we are kindred spirits. And what I feel in them, I feel in myself. The way empathy emerges, a child has kind of a sense of it, and then when they can see themselves in the mirror, they know, okay, I'm a human being. When they're about 8 years old, they learn about death. That's a big deal. That matures empathy if you have good parenting. If you have proper, as Mr. Bowlby would have said, proper empathic engagement. But to be able to understand the world we live in, we have to understand that that mortality and life is the animating force. AI is not about life, all right? So to say that they're going to replace human beings, empathy is the way we engage with each other as kindred spirits on this planet. There is no AI, and I would venture to ask any one of them, how are you going to have empathy in a machine when it has to do with living beings attached to other living beings? Whether it's noticing a wounded fox that we have to take care of, to understanding that each of us has a one and only life, and we share it with each other. We're kindred spirits on this planet. And when we get old, we become old people, I can tell you the things we most remember are those experiences of empathic engagement. That's our memories. It isn't how much we made in money. It isn't anything like that. It's the empathic moments, either experiencing someone else's joy, their jubilance, or their grievances, so that we can understand life is so precious. It's the precious quality of life, same as we experience it with another being. Could be your pet dog, all right? So my God, let's get off this idea of the singularity and immortality. Let's grow up here. There's a room for digital technology. There's a room for data. There's a room for analytics. And we certainly use it in the third industrial revolution infrastructure, but nature is much more complicated than anything they're ever going to be able to do in Palo Alto. And we're best off if we learn to be humble, to engage, and to be open to what the planet brings us so that we can live and flourish on it.
Changing the subject, Dr. Rifkin, you defend collaborative and interdependence between, we were talking about this before, but this is divorced with the concept of success that we have now. How young people need to rethink their concept of success.
Well, I mean, you know, there's been some activity in this area. You know, we grew up with gross domestic product, the idea that we can measure well-being by GDP. Now, it wasn't a very good measure. Even the guy who created it in the 40s apologized later because GDP measures everything. If you are building a tank or a nuclear bomb, that's GDP. If you're creating new prisons, private prisons, that's GDP. If you're cleaning up toxic waste dumps, that's GDP. It doesn't tell you about the quality of life. So many years ago, some friends of mine actually created the first quality of life indicator, QLI. European Union's now done it. The UN's done it. I think other development groups have done it, but they still rely on GDP. So quality of life indicators is, okay, infant mortality, how bad is it in the country? How good? The child's education, how good is it? The ability to serve in the community and volunteer, life expectancy, all of these things that make up good health, quality of life, that's the better indicators. They have them in theory, but they don't really rely on them in practice. We need to begin to take a look at changing the way we, quote, measure the good life. So we need to mature again when it comes to understanding what makes success. Success is living a life well lived, an empathic engagement with the rest of the life force on the planet. When we go out into nature, they've done experiments. I have this in the Age of Resilience book, actually. They take a look at what makes people happy. It's the simplest things. And Japan is kind of the test story because in Japan, the work ethic went crazy and they had a term for it. People were dying at their desk 24 hours a day working. They were the first 24/7 society, 24 hours a day, dying at their desk. Finally, people just walked out and they went into the local park or forest and they just took a walk. It was spontaneous. They couldn't stand it anymore. And guess what? What they found, the scientists then studied it, of course, and it's called forest bathing. Okay, forest bathing. They go out and just walk in the woods. What they found in study after study is that our internal biological clocks are entrained to the natural world. The more we're isolated from that, the more it undermines our health. A 1 mile walk, just a slow walk in the forest without even thinking about it, it completely changes your metabolism. It's not up here. It's in your physicality. It changes the entire metabolism of the body so that you calm down, your system is working better because it's actually biologically entrained those clocks to nature. You don't have to think about it. They've done study after study after study. So that's why we've got to get out in the physical world. We can't present it on a screen in a video and say to the young people, now you understand ecology. You've just seen a 20-minute video with a lot of excitement. No, that's not how to do it. A lot of this is common sense. Sometimes it's embarrassingly simple, but it's also a profound understanding we need to have.
You put my feeling is that you put the responsibility on the political will, right? But I want to ask you, what would you say to those citizens that they just live their lives without caring and putting the responsibility of what is going on in the planet to others?
Well, because in our day-to-day life, sure, there's the day-to-day things we have to do. I wrote a book, for example, called Beyond Beef in 1990, Rise and Fall of Cattle Culture. And when I wrote that book, not a single environmental organization in the world would endorse it. It was too frightening for them. All right, things have changed. It's taken 30 years. Yeah, reduce your beef consumption, all right? I mean, you know, if you were from another part of the universe and landed here, you would think cattle were the dominant species. They take up 23% of the remaining land mass of the planet. The methane they produce is 24 times more potent than CO2. And 30 to 40% of all the food grain we grow, the wheat and barley, it all goes to cattle. Well, people don't have enough to eat. So there are things we can do in our everyday life. A young generation are becoming vegans. That's extraordinary. And new families, and they're bringing up their children that way. There are all sorts of things we can do. I don't want to go into all the day-to-day things and don't use plastic and all that kind of stuff. But what I'm saying is, as parents, it's a matter of how do we acclimate our children to the natural world. That's number one. Now, the good thing in Europe is you still like your weekends to go out into nature, all right? We need to acclimate our children when they're little babies not to be afraid to have biophilia consciousness. We need to let them have their children steward their fellow creatures. We need to let the parents, when they are with their children through the school system, make sure those school systems are preparing them for living in a biophilia world, all right? And not a geopolitical world, a biospheric world. There's so many things parents can do, but also every person that's working. There are people working in all sorts of jobs. Bring your ideas into the job, whether you're unskilled, semi-skilled, skilled, technical, professional. There's all sorts of days around the water cooler or on the internet when you're working with fellow employees. You can think in a different way. You can think in a different way in your particular job that you're doing, a responsibility. And I should say ecosystem services are going to be the huge employment because they require massive amounts of intelligent labor. And you can be trained to anybody, intelligent labor, to steward ecosystems. And again, robots and AI don't steward ecosystems. Try to imagine a robot and an AI trying to figure out how to steward all of the life force in some small ecosystem. It just can't be done. So there are lots of ways we can do it in our personal life, as parents, as young people going through the school system, as employers and employees in the workplace. It should be a way of life.
Dr. Rifkin, this interview is coming to an end. I want to ask you for a final message to all these people listening to this conversation. What are the urgencies?
There's one urgency, and that is we have to make sure that our species does not go into the fossil fuel record. There's one emergency. There's only one. We are in an extinction event. We have to make sure it doesn't become a reality. We have to do whatever is necessary now to rethink our relationship to this planet and our relationship to our fellow human beings and our relationship to our fellow creatures. You know, when our astronauts come back from space, they all say the same story. There's nothing out there. They come back and they see this blue marble alive in the universe. Everything else is dark. They've got the new telescope out there looking at other galaxies. They're not seeing any life. this is so precious. There may be life in other places, but it's so precious. We have to be able to step back, every one of us, I don't care how old we are, from the time a little kid is four or five, six years old, and we have to appreciate the majesty of life, how important it is, how special it is in the universe. We have to steward it, and not only our life, but our fellow creatures. That's why when the young people see themselves as a species now, endangered species, that's a big deal. That's a turning point in history. When we realize that the planet's much more powerful than we thought, and we're much smaller and less significant, that's a humble reality we need to grasp and not be afraid of. Then we have to realize that because we have the biggest brain, because we have language, because we have empathy in our neural circuitry, we have a responsibility. And it's not about taking nature and adapting to us. Because of our special speciesness, we have responsibility now to change our course and adapt us to nature and help steward the possibilities for our fellow creatures to survive and flourish on this earth too. And for the young people, I would say this. Persevere. Do not get frustrated. Do not shorten your attention span. Do not say it's all over. Yes, you've protested. I'm going to be a little critical here. You've gone out on the streets. You're protesting on Fridays, and you're having some civil disobedience and other things. You're constantly pointing out that we are in a climate event, but we have to have the courage and the perseverance to whatever we do in the classroom when we're called upon, in the job where we're at, in the children that you produce, the next generation, constantly be aware of the special quality of life that is now endangered on this little planet in the universe, and that we want to make sure that we have left a real legacy, which is to allow a new generation to flourish in new ways on this earth. It won't be the way we're flourishing now. I'm not going to kid people. The good old days are not here anymore, the nice temperate climate. We're going to have to flourish in new ways. It may be a more Spartan, but quality of life rather than a quantity of life. It may be that we'll have more periods of nomadic migration and lesser periods of sedentary life. But you know, we've been a nomadic species all through history, all right? And we always think we're sedentary, but the average American moves 9 times during their lifetime, all right? Millions of people immigrate all the time. The biggest industry is travel and tourism. So I want to leave you with this thought. The Smithsonian Institution, our great anthropology museums in America that everybody visits when they come to America, they did a study recently. It's eye-opening, and this will give everyone that's hearing this, this will give them hope. They did a study, and they said, how did human beings survive all of this time? Hominids have been here 800,000 years ago, our ancestors, then Neanderthals 300,000 years ago, then our species about 200,000 years ago. How did we survive? The old story that you and I grew up on is, well, 10,000 years ago, the last ice age receded. We don't know what happened before that. The last ice age receded. Nice climate, good weather. We settled down to agriculture, pasteurization, hydraulic civilizations, all the way to industrial revolution. Yes, now we're in an extinction event, all right? But then the Smithsonian said, well, how did human beings then travel the whole planet? How did they cross oceans? And they went back and they looked at the geological record and they said, oh my God, we got it wrong. Here's how we really survived. Hominids emerged about 800,000 years ago, right? And at that time, there was a change in the orbiting of the planet. The orbit of the planet tilts, and it changes in its tilts. And as the tilting changes, it brings it either closer to the sun or further from the sun. So there was a change in the tilt of the planet 800,000 years ago, and that tilt forced a change in climate every 100,000 years since. So we would have 100,000 years of a complete ice age, then 10,000 years of warming, then another 100,000 years of ice age, 10,000 years of warming, then another 100,000 years of ice age, then 10,000 years of warming. 8 cycles of this till the last ice age deglaciated 10,000 years ago. How did we adapt to this? That's extreme change in climate. And what they concluded is that our species is perhaps the most adaptive mammalian species on the planet. We may be one of the most adaptive species with the exception of viruses. That's what I would say. Why? Big brain, large neocortex, and language. we can share what we learn over history, and then we can bring it on to generations not yet here to give them a frame of reference on where they want to go. And then we have, and this is what I would say, we have empathy in our neural circuitry. We are born to cooperate. That doesn't mean that sometimes we don't slaughter each other, kill each other, but that's not our normal neural circuitry. That is not our normal neural circuitry. So even passing the oceans, they wondered how did the Pacific Island nations get life before the modern times? Well, it turns out the Polynesian boaters, they would learn in Polynesian islands, those thousand islands, they learned how to go out in their little boats and watch the stars. And then they actually watched the stars because they were fixed. Then they would watch birds, and they know if the birds were out in the ocean, then they would go back to an island, they'd follow them. And most important, they watched the motions of the waters. The waters were changing each moment. And they could memorize this unbelievable amount of information and go island to island across the entire Pacific Ocean. This is an adaptive species. And what I say to every young person, if you think we can't make it, not understand, we are one of the most adaptive species that ever been on the planet. We took a wrong turn, and we tried to force the planet to adapt to us. That was only 5% of our time here. Now let's reset and adapt back to the planet with sophistication, with complex systems thinking, with interdisciplinary studies, with biophilia for our young people, with an understanding that life itself in this universe is here right now. And we've got to do this every moment of every day. We will experience life as joyful, even if it's difficult. We will flourish in new ways that may not, maybe be more Spartan and not quantitative. We'll have a better life. This can happen. It needs to be done today.
I love your hope at the end of the conversation. Dr. Rifkin, thank you very much for being here with us in Aprendemos Juntos today. It's been such a pleasure. And thank you for your time and for sharing your knowledge.
Thank you.